Hello and welcome to the second video in this series of videos about bicycle wheel building. Today in this video I'll talk about choosing good quality components. And so here we have a hub that is for a wheel to be built. This is for a single speed bicycle hub. This one is Shimano Dura-Ace. It has good quality cup and cone bearings and nicely built flanges, and generally when you choose hubs you want to go with wheels. My recommendation at least is to go, as I explained in the previous video, about the number of crosses and spoke count and how spoke tension and number of spokes influences wheel strength. So I would recommend going for 32 or even 36 spokes and avoiding modern trends of having very few spokes. It can look cool, but there are some problems with that, because when you have just say 16 spokes on a front wheel, in case one spoke breaks, that's a lot of difference in total tension on the whole wheel, on the whole rim, and so the rim will deflect in the direction opposite to the side where the spoke had broken off, and you might see it start rubbing even against a fork, which can be problematic and perhaps even dangerous when you are going downhill or something. While with a wheel that has 36, or even especially for those tandem bicycle wheels that have 40 spokes, I've seen them break one spoke and almost stay true, because there is so little difference made by that one spoke totally going out of play that, okay, I'm exaggerating, such wheels always come out of true, of course, but they don't necessarily even start to scratch on the rim brakes. So those are some radical differences, while all the, let's say, more conservative wheels with 32 or 36 spokes are somewhere in between. But I think it's for safety and for durability, reliability, it's better to have more spokes. So that's the first thing that I want to mention, like choose hub with at least 32 spokes or 36. The next thing we need to consider are the rings. Here I have a few examples and we'll take a look at them. Just paying attention not to scratch them. This is one. Now, let's start with this one. This is super cheap, about under $10 here in Serbia. Rim that has double walls. I don't know if you can see it here. It's got hollow midsection and it's like a sort of a box. Okay. This enables it to be at the same time relatively light while still being rather strong. And so aluminium as a rim material is good, because it, unlike carbon, it's of course it's lighter than steel. So steel rims are not very, very light, even if they are made to be hollow or double walled or something. They're not very light, while aluminium allows to keep enough strength while still making them not too heavy. And also, if you're using rim brakes, aluminium is much better performing when braking compared to steel, especially in the wet, especially when it's raining. So that's another plus. And talk about carbon fiber rims. They are very popular because they are very stiff and very light. Those are the marketing slogans used with them, and they are not lying, but it's not the whole story. It's marketing. This is my opinion, of course. You are free to disagree. You have the comment section. Anyway, so with carbon fiber rims, the problem is they are often made to be relatively deep and they are very stiff. So when you are pedaling hard uphill and you push your bicycle from one side to another, the force of your whole body and bicycle uses the whole rim as a lever. And if a rim is very stiff, it will not bend at the contact point with the ground, like aluminium rims, even the double-walled ones do. They do bend. But with the carbon fiber rims, because they are so stiff and super light, they will stay completely in line, and so the whole wheel will move, making the bicycle's dropouts bend a bit, which is not probably very nice for the dropouts, but it's even worse because it will start scratching on the frame if there is very tight tolerance, and definitely if you use road bicycle and rim brakes, it can start to scratch on your rim brakes. You need to use that quick release on the rim brakes of road bikes when you want to climb a hill. So it's not very, those are the, too much of something is not always the optimal option, the best. Now, what are my objections to this rim? Well, my first objection is that it's made rather cheaply, so not all the material is taken out in places where it can be afforded for the material to be taken out. So these walls are a bit thicker than they have to be, and it's relatively heavy compared to more expensive rims. And another thing I don't like is that it does not have any sort of preparation for this interface of the nipple and the rim, which is this side inside. So the nipple is turned directly over the aluminium wall, which is probably one of the reasons why the wall is made so thick, so that the nipple doesn't push through it and or damage it too much. And still, this needs to be lubricated very well, and I usually use some anti-seize paste when I build wheels using rims like this, because I don't want any galvanic corrosion between the brass nipples and aluminium rims, in order to prevent that, so that the rims can be used later in case a rim gets damaged. You can easily unscrew the nipples and replace the rim and so on. So that's my main complaint for this rim. I'll put it aside and take a look at another one. I might list all the weights and prices in the video comment section. Anyway, this is a bit more expensive rim. Here we have a make for those interested. None of these videos have anything to do with any manufacturer, so this is not an advert. I'm just trying to explain things. This one is 32 holes, and here the thing I don't like about this rim, it's the holes are not very, it's not very deep, so there's not much strength in it, and it will probably take a lot less total tension of the spokes compared to the previously shown rim. That is one disadvantage. All the other things are super cool. It's rather light, and it has these, I don't know the proper English term, but these are made of metal, of steel. It's not aluminium. They're like reinforcements, like some sort of sleeves, and they go all the way from the outer box and to the inside of the rim where the spoke nipples are held against. So it makes the force that nipple puts on the rim be to some degree dispensed over a wider area, both on the outer side and on the inner side. So that's a good thing. Another advantage is that this steel is a lot harder than aluminium, so turning the nipple when the spoke is under tension will not start to damage aluminium, but the nipple will turn against steel, and so some light machine oil is enough to lubricate this rim before starting to lacen it and bring it to tension, and it will work fine. And these rims are generally, the ones that are made with this, if it's good quality, are generally a bit easier to work with. Unfortunately, I want to add this as well, and I don't mean again to say anything nice or bad against any single company. It's not about that. Just trying to share my experience and point out to some probable problems. And so in some Mavic rims, M-A-V-I-C, not sure how it's pronounced, it's French make, I've seen even when the rims are built to look perfectly fine, like they have these sort of strengthening points and they are double-walled aluminium, everything looks nice, you buy them for 32 or 36 spokes, doesn't matter. After some, I don't know, 10,000 kilometers or so, they start developing a crack along the midsection of the rim. That is something that is, in my opinion, obviously because of bad engineering, they have not taken into account all the loads that bicycle wheels take, and they have taken too much material off or haven't used good quality material, whatever. But it's not good, it's not long lasting. Another thing that I don't like, and I will show it on this one because it's more obvious, that's, this is the latest kit for about, I don't know, 20 years. Like, okay, these brakes are becoming more and more popular. I'll put a link to my website's article about the advantages and disadvantages of these brakes compared to rim brakes. But when using rim brakes, these are the machined side walls. Like, this is made, it's cut by some sort of machining process, so it's nice and even, and you don't need to work these kind of rims in by breaking. They are already factory made to be like this kind of flat. And the disadvantage of that is that, because when you take a, this is like made from a rod or from a pipe, like sort of a pipe that is hollow on the inside and the holes are punctured, and then it is bent together and it's put together by, in one place, either by welding or by putting some other sort of attachment. I'm trying to find the place where this is put together. Sorry, I'll just take a few seconds to look around. Okay, here it is. This is the point where it's joined together. So you're bound to have it a bit like sort of buckle or be wider at some points because you're bending it. And they take a machine and then take it out and make it even, but the machine takes out too much material, and that fine polishing can be done by using your own rim brakes, and after a few breakings in the wet, it would be perfectly fine and you would not feel any brake judder or something. But the machining is good because it sounds cool for the marketing, and you get them to be right from the box, like straight and looking cool, but they will not last as long, or they would need to have this extra thick to compensate for that, compared to not machining them in the first place. Another crazy thing that some manufacturers do is anodizing aluminium on the outside, even on the parts where the brakes are going wrong, and that is also very bad because the anodized aluminium is harder, and when brakes go along it might develop cracks inside the structure of the aluminium or the rims material before the pads manage to take off all the anodizing on the outside. I don't see why brake material where brakes go should be painted in any way. Anyway, those are some of the exotic things I wanted to mention, and I think I've covered now the rim selection. In short, you don't have a lot to choose. It's almost impossible to find a good quality rim that is made to be durable, unfortunately. So you can choose between several types of rims that are all bad in one way or another, either too heavy or made to not last too long. So, or you have to pay an arm and a leg, like $100 for one rim instead of 10. So it's crazy, but that's the way the whole industry goes, and that's what you have to work with. Now let's go to the spokes, putting this aside. When it comes to spokes, the intuitive thing that people can come to mind is, like, if you want a wheel to be durable, you need thick spokes. Well, the problem with that is, as I have mentioned in my previous video, that the rim is the limiting factor and it can only take so much total spoke tension. And when spokes become loose, when they don't have enough tension, that is when the spokes will start cracking. Spokes mostly crack due to material fatigue, and to explain it, like, simply, on a micro level, what happens when a spoke breaks, they usually break at the elbows, it is like not enough tension, so they work a bit, they get loose, then tensioned a bit, and when they're not held tight, they move around, and you're practically like taking a wire and doing this only on a micro level, but it's hundreds of thousands of revolutions and small movements, but it's like this, and when you take a wire and do this, it will break after 2, 3, or 10 times. With wheels it takes a bit longer, but they eventually break. So the spokes that are too thick will not have enough tension, they will not be held tight enough by the strength that the rim can hold, or the total tension, so they will start to develop cracks and often break at the elbows. If the spokes are too thin, on the other hand, the weak part is the part where the nipple goes, because if you have a spoke that is too thin, the nipple threads, unfortunately, are not made to have some finer thread for the thinner spokes. So spokes that have at the threaded end the 1.8 millimeter thickness, or the thinner ones, they will have too little material in the middle when you take out all the cut threads for the nipple. So the problem is that becomes a weak spot and cracks happen there, so they break off at the nipple end. And so there is only an optimal choice when it comes to spokes, and in my opinion, those are the optimal spokes are those that are 2 millimeters thick, and preferably the ones that are thinned down to 1.8 millimeters in the midsection only. Why in the midsection? I'll take one spoke to demonstrate. Just a moment. Okay, here we have a spoke. Now, as I've tried to explain, the weak parts that have most stress are the elbow and this part where the nipple goes. These spokes very, very rarely break at this section because it has the least amount of stress, unless you use some mechanical force like hit something or so it breaks. But generally, this is not a problem where the fatigue stress happen. So when you thin it down in the middle, what you get is, you can imagine this to become like sort of a rubber, like sort of a shock absorber. So any extra strain that a spoke takes gets taken out by the midsection that is otherwise not under a great deal of strain or stress. So it will elongate a bit more, but it will put off some extra stress and load on the end sections. That's one advantage of it. The other advantage is when you thin it down at the middle, it will elongate a bit more. So when a rim is compressed for any reason under any load or moved aside closer to one hub flange, so that it effectively comes closer and the spoke is put under lower tension, when it is elongated more during the wheel build, it will have more give before it becomes completely unloaded. So these kinds of spokes are a lot less likely to become unwinded and loosened, and the wheel to become untrue when it's built with spokes that are thinned down in the middle. An important thing to consider here is the metal, the material structure. When spokes are thinned down in the middle, it's not done by grinding, so you shouldn't buy a spoke that is straight 2 millimeters all the way and then try to file it down in the middle, because that way you will create another stress source and it will break in the middle in that case. But it's usually done in the factory by rolling them. So the material's inner structure, the crystallized structure of the metal, I'm not a mechanical engineer, so you will excuse me and please correct me if I've used any wrong terms, especially wrong terms for the English language. But the point is that when it's done in the factory and it's done properly, those spokes are perfect. There are some extra quality spokes, extra strong spokes, that have this side to be 2 millimeters, but this side at the elbow that is usually for the 2 millimeter spoke thickness, the part where spokes failed, and this is made to be 2.3 millimeters. So such spokes that have 2.3, 1.8 and 2 millimeters here are considered to be extra strong. However, in my experience, I've heard some experienced riders and mechanics swear by these spokes. In my experience, I haven't managed to notice any difference, or anyone whose wheels I had built has never had any problems with spokes that are just 2 millimeters, 1.8 and 2 millimeters. So that's as good as it gets, in my opinion, and especially it's a good value in terms of bang for the buck, as the Americans say. And another thing about spokes, again, this is not, unfortunately, it's not paid by any company, but I want to recommend what I have learned to be good spokes, and it boils down to two manufacturers. One is DT Swiss, and the other one is SAPIM, SAPIM or SAPIM, not sure how it's pronounced, but those two spoke manufacturers make good quality spokes and nipples, and I do not buy or use any others whenever it is possible. The problem with Serbia, it's impossible to source, and there are no good quality distributors, so this goes to both SAPIM and DT Swiss. Please make some sort of distribution for Serbia. It's impossible to find and source your spokes. No matter, if you want to wait 6 months, you still cannot get it. You have to go abroad and buy it and bring it in. It's awful. Okay, so that's a bit of a complaining, but back to the topic. So those will be my choices of spoke material, and now we've got only nipples. And let's see about nipples. Again, DT Swiss or SAPIM. Aluminium nipples will galvanically corrode more easily. They are a bit lighter, but that is their only advantage. They're softer and they galvanically corrode, get stuck, so I would not recommend using anything but brass nipples. And when it comes to brass nipples, for most trims, 12 millimeter ones are perfectly fine. And some rims might require a bit longer nipples. And another thing that I like about using 12 millimeter nipples is they you can build your calculations. I will talk about that when choosing spoke lengths, and when you're doing so, you need to account for the length of the nipple being chosen. And since in Serbia it is often difficult to find good quality spokes in all lengths, when I make calculations for these kinds of nipples in 12 millimeters, in case I can only find spokes that are 1 or 2 millimeters shorter, I can compensate for that by using nipples that are 14 or 16 millimeters at length, because by SAPIM and DT Swiss at least, they require the spokes to be respectively 1 or 2 millimeters shorter, because their threads start a bit lower, bit deeper down the spoke. Here I will try to demonstrate the difference. And just so that it's obvious, 12 and 16 millimeters nipple, and 40 millimeters is of course somewhere in between. And so here with this one, spoke threads will end near this part where this flat insertion is inserted, while with 16 millimeter nipples it will be 2 millimeters lower. That's as far as the threads go, and for 40 millimeters it's somewhere in between, just 1 millimeter lower. So you can use them to your advantage even if the rim does not require them. That is something that I've had to learn to improvise, because in Serbia we improvise with everything. It's a way of life. And another thing I want to point out, because I have praised this book, and I sent an email to the author, that in my experience the SAPIM nipples that I can find are also like the DT Swiss that he describes in his book. So the differences in spoke length are also present with SAPIM, unlike what he wrote that it is only with the case with DT Swiss. Maybe the updated edition will show this difference. I'm not sure where to find it, but don't want to waste time on the video. Okay, here's a great picture. I hope the author won't mind me for using this, but this is what I'm talking about with 12, 14 and 60 millimeters depth of nipples, length of nipples. So I think I've covered mostly the things about components. Another thing I want to talk about, and sorry if this video is very long, again I suggest you read the book, it's probably more efficient way to learn. I will be making videos where I demonstrate things later on. This is the boring part, Tarzan English and long talk. Avoid exotic things. The spokes that have no elbows, hubs that are made for those straight spokes with no elbows, not sure how they are called in English, but anything that is exotic is usually a lot more expensive, it's more difficult to source when you need it, especially if you're somewhere on the road, or even if you are at home, depending on your city or country, it might take weeks or months for it to be ordered and imported and so on. And there's no real practical advantage. The only exception are the racers, people who race. Usually, if your sponsor is buying stuff, of course you let them decide, because they want to advertise and sell stuff, so you have no choice when it comes to that. But even for the racers, in terms of performance, I don't think there's a lot of reason to go with anything that is too exotic and too difficult to find and source. This goes too for the nipples. Some rims and nipples, some made by Mavic, have special sort of threads, like you need to turn the outer side, and they use special tools for that. I think I have some here for those, and just it's nonsense, and there's really no reason for going for that. No practical one. And I think I've covered it all, and sorry for the long talk. We'll now get on with the other videos, and thank you for watching. Any suggestions, comments, especially corrections, are more than welcome in order to make this more useful and better. And that's it. Cheers.